Audio Jungle. Audio Jungle. Audio Jungle.
A Republican lawmaker told Joint Chiefs of STAFF Chairman General Mark Milley point blank that he should hand in his resignation letter on Wednesday over two phone calls made to his counterpart in China assuring him that former President Trump is not thinking of an imminent attack. Milley, Defense Secretary Lloyd Austin and U.S. Central Command Chief General Frank McKenzie are appearing before the House Armed Services Committee today in the second of two contentious hearings on the Biden administration's Afghanistan withdrawal. It's also the second time in 2 days that Milley finds himself on the road answering for allegations against being Trump's back to tell a Chinese general that he'd personally deliver a heads up if the ex-president took rogue action against China in a desperate bid to stay in office. Rep. Vicky Hartzler, RMO, asked Milley about the contents of his conversation with Beijing during her questioning. She accused him of working against the USA to help her number one adversary, adding that his actions were worthy of resignation. Did you tell General Li when you talked to him on the phone if we would attack China that you would let him know ahead of time? Hartzler asked. Milley didn't deny the allegation but told the lawmaker that it was part of a longer conversation. The Chinese thought wrongly that United States was going to attack them. I'm guaranteed certain that President Trump had no intent to attack and it was my task to make sure he communicated that, and the purpose was to de-escalate, he said. Milley's defense echoed much of the same points as his Tuesday statement. As part of that conversation, he said General Li, there is not going to be a war, there is not going to be attack between great powers. If there was, the tension would build up, there would be calls going back between all kinds of senior officials. He said, Ehol, I'll probably give you a call but we're not going to attack you. Hartzler replied, understand your intent but I think you articulating that you would tell him, you would give him a call, I think is worthy of your resignation. I just think that's against our country, that you would give our number one adversary that information. The allegations were made in Peril, a new book by Bob Woodward and Robert Costa. It cited Beijing's fears that Trump was looking to start a war with China as his potential election loss loomed. Milley confirmed the broad premise of the book but denied that the calls were secret. Another Republican lawmaker, Rep. Scott DeHarlais, RTN, also pressed Milley on the calls. The Tennessee Republican asked Milley if he made the calls to China because he was concerned about Trump's mental state. No, I didn't. What he said to the call to China was, I guarantee you that President Trump is not going to attack you in a surprise attack. I was carrying out his intent, President Trump's intent, in order to protect the American people, Milley answered. DeHarlais asked Milley about another allegation in Peril, where according to a transcript obtained by the author's speaker Nancy Pelosi made disparaging comments about Trump. Pelosi reportedly called the ex-president crazy and asked is there anybody in charge of the White House is doing anything but kissing his fat butt all over this. Milley wouldn't say whether he recalled the exact question, but said he told the speaker that he was not qualified to assess the mental health of the president. During the Wednesday hearing, Milley also said it was then Defense Secretary Mark Esper who directed him to make the calls to China after numerous intelligence reports indicated that Beijing feared an attack was imminent. Was directed by then Secretary of Defense Esper. First, he directed his Assistant Secretary of Defense for Asia-Pacific Affairs to make calls and then me. This is all done with oversight, and he tried to lay that out in the memoranda, the embattled general said. It comes after GOP Senator Josh Hawley said Joe Biden should fire his Joint Chief of STAFF and Secretary of Defense if they do not resign for their failure to take responsibility for the chaotic scenes in Afghanistan. A Republican senator for Missouri who was at Tuesday's Senate hearing, Hawley said on Tuesday night that General Mark Milley and Secretary Lloyd Austin must face the AEX over their unrepentant appearances before a Senate committee Tuesday. Earlier in the day, the country heard for the first time that the top generals advised the commander-in-chief to leave 2,500 U.S. troops in Afghanistan to prevent a Taliban takeover. Republicans accused President Biden of lying to the American people, because he repeatedly said that he was not recommended to keep troops in the country. Hawley, speaking to Fox News and Hannity along with Senator Tom Cotton of Arkansas, said he was dismayed by the accounts of Milley and Austin. Jen. Millie doesn't want any responsibility, Austin doesn't want responsibility, and most of all, Joe Biden doesn't want to take any responsibility, but it's time that they did, which is why all those guys should resign, said Holly. Millie needs to resign, Austin needs to resign. Holly said he was particularly angered by Millie's admission on Tuesday that he spoke to journalist Bob Woodward for his new book telling the story of the final stretch of the Trump administration. Mean Millie, is sitting here trading gossip with Bob Woodward while Afghanistan literally burns, said Holly. Accountability needs to start right there. He needs to resign, Austin needs to resign, the president should fire him. Cotton said that Biden had been lying about the advice the generals gave him, and said he was doing it to cover up his tracks in the aftermath of the disastrous withdrawal from Afghanistan. That's what we've heard today, that President Biden repeatedly rejected the advice of his military commanders and that's what led to this disaster and now has been lying about it, said Cotton. Think the very simple question is covering up his tracks in the middle of an ongoing fiasco. Testimony provided earlier on Tuesday by the country's defense secretary and two senior generals contradicted Biden's claims he was never warned by military advisors that bringing home American soldiers risked the collapse of a fragile government in Kabul. The result was a SLW of furious accusations that Biden ignored advice and then lied to the country. Holley said during the hearing. Here's what I've learned so far. Number 1, the President of the United States lied to the American people about the advice that you gave to him, about the military judgment that you provided for him. Think you've all testified to that effect now repeatedly. Biden has been under intense pressure to defend his handling of the withdrawal. The Taliban moved rapidly across the country ahead of his August 31 deadline to get Americans out of Afghanistan, says in the capital Kabul on August 15. Biden and his officials have insisted the speed of their advance and the collapse of Afghan security forces took them by surprise. In an August 18 interview with George Stephanopoulos, the president even denied that he withdrew troops against the recommendation of his senior military advisors. Both M.S. Kenzie, head of U.S. Central Command and who oversaw the final days of the war in Afghanistan, said he repeatedly argued that a small presence of U.S. troops was essential for stability. Stated consistently that my position was, if you go below 2,500 you're going to look at a collapse of the Afghan military, he told the Senate Armed Services Committee. Didn't he did not foresee it to be days. He thought it would take months. In response, the White House tried to play down the testimony and the idea that Biden had ignored the advice of senior military advisors. Press Secretary Jen Psaki tweeted that Biden had told Stephanopoulos that his advisors were divided, and later said that he was entitled to choose between a range of recommendations. As the commander-in-chief, she said during the daily briefing. As the president. Makes decisions about that what's in the national interest, and they believe we should end the war. Made his comments at the start of 2 days of intense scrutiny of the Biden administration's Afghan strategy, sitting alongside Secretary of Defense Lloyd Austin and Gen. Mark Milley, chairman of the Joint Chiefs of STAFF. Milley also said his view had been that leaving the country, without meeting specific conditions, would likely lead to the collapse of the Afghan armed forces and government. He told lawmakers, in the fall of 2020, my analysis was that an accelerated withdrawal without meeting specific and necessary conditions risks losing the substantial gains made in Afghanistan, damaging U.S. worldwide credibility, and could precipitate a general collapse of the Afghan government, resulting in a complete Taliban takeover or general civil war. That was a year ago, my assessment remained consistent throughout. Some 3,500 U.S. troops were in the country when President Biden was inaugurated. Milley declined to say exactly what advised the president, but that it was his personal view that 2,500 American troops were needed to prevent collapse. His words triggered immediate scrutiny of Biden's comments defending his actions in August at the height of the crisis. During an interview with ABC News, he denied that his military advisors warned him against bringing home all troops or that at least 2,500 were needed to prevent a Taliban takeover. He no one said that to me that he can recall, he told interviewer Stephanopoulos, CNN. Tom Cotton brought up the interview during the hearing, asking Austin whether Biden was telling the truth when he said that no senior military advisor told him to leave a small military presence. After saying that Biden was an honest and forthright man, Austin admitted, "Sir, input was received by the president and considered by the president, for sure. In terms of what they specifically recommended, Senator, as they just said, they were not going to provide what they recommended in confidence." The testimony triggered a wave of condemnation. Republican Senator Ben Sasse, a member of the Senate Select Committee on Intelligence, said, President Biden lied when he told the American people that nobody urged him to keep 2,500 troops in Afghanistan. Today, on the road, General M.S. Kenzie flatly contradicted the president. This is the worst American foreign policy disaster in a generation, and the president is trying to cover his ass with political spin. Republican Senator Marsha Blackburn, who sits on the Armed Services Committee, said, from what we are hearing, President Biden rejected military advice to keep 2,500 troops in Afghanistan and then lied about it to the American people. Mark Meadows, chief of STIFF in the Trump White House, said, if it wasn't already obvious, today's Senate hearing confirmed. Joe Biden lied to the America people about his Afghanistan withdrawal plan. The president was entitled to reject the general's advice, said Leon Panetta, who was Secretary of Defense under President Obama. But I do think it needs to be clear that the advice was given, and the advice was rejected, he told CNN. The episode severely tested Biden's claim to be a foreign policy expert. His approval ratings collapse amid images of Afghans clinging to US transport planes as they desperately sought to escape their new Taliban rulers. A suicide blast killed 13 U.S. service personnel and 169 Afghans in the last days of the chaotic evacuation. Days later, a drone strike killed 10 civilians despite U.S. claims the missile targeted terrorists in the final stages of launching an attack. Gen. Milley and the others defended the drawdown but admitted the operation did not go smoothly. It was a logistical success but a strategic failure, he said. Impact on U.S. credibility. The speed of the withdrawal also triggered anger from U.S. allies, such as Britain, where ministers said they were blindsided by the rapid departure and the launch of a chaotic, frantic evacuation of foreign nationals. Milley said the episode had a damaging impact on U.S. standing in the world. Think that our credibility with allies and partners around the world, and with adversaries, is being intensely reviewed by them to see which way this is going to go, he said. And I think that damage is one word that could be used. It was left to Austin to defend the administration. Think our credibility remained solid. He said, clearly there will be people who question things going forward. Senators on the Armed Services Committee also heard warnings that the country could still present a terrorist threat to American soil. Officials have said all along that the rapid collapse of Afghanistan in 11 days, as the Taliban advanced rapidly across the country, took them by surprise. Afghan army's rapid collapse for his part, Austin defended the military's execution of the chaotic Kabul airlift but blamed the fall of Kabul on the Afghan army's sudden collapse. To be clear, those first 2 days were difficult, he said. We all watched with alarm the images of Afghans rushing the wrong way and that aircraft. We all remember the scenes of confusion outside the airport. But within 48 hours, our troops restored order, and process began to take hold. Despite 20 years of U.S. presence in the country, he admitted that Washington failed to forge a nation that could stand on its own feet. The fact that the Afghan army, that we and our partners trained, simply melted away, in many cases without firing a shot, took us all by surprise and it would be dishonest to claim otherwise, he said. We need to consider some uncomfortable truths that we didn't fully comprehend. The depth of corruption and poor leadership in the senior ranks that we didn't grasp. The damaging effect of the frequent and unexplained rotations by President Ghani of his commanders, that we didn't anticipate the snowball effect caused by the deals that the Taliban commanders struck with local leaders in the wake of the Doha Agreement, and that the Doha Agreement itself had a demoralizing effect on Afghan soldiers. Row of Bagram Air Base Austin also tried to head off questions about whether the evacuation operation would have been more successful if the military had not shot down Bagram Air Base. Retaining Bagram would have required putting as many as 5,000 US troops in harm's way just to operate and defend it, and it would have contributed little to the mission that we've been assigned, and that was to protect and defend the embassy which was some 30 miles away. That distance from Kabul also rendered Bagram of little value in the evacuation. Mackenzie also defended the closure under questioning from Democratic Senator Jackie Rosen. Can't tell you that once we went below 2,500 people in Afghanistan, we lost the ability to hold Bagram Air Base, he said. And it was inevitable that we were going to have to come out of Bagram because we ended up in late June, early July, with 650 Marines and soldiers in the country. It was not feasible to hold Bagram under those circumstances. Terrorist threat against US soil. Biden has repeatedly declared that the degradation of Al-Qaeda meant the original mission of US troops in Afghanistan had been completed. Both senators were told that the Taliban remained a terrorist organization and had never broken its ties with Al-Qaeda. "Have no illusions who we are dealing with," said Milley during his opening statement. "It remains to be seen whether or not the Taliban can consolidate power or if the country will further fracture into civil war. But we must continue to protect the United States of America and its people from terrorist attacks coming from Afghanistan. A reconstituted Al-Qaeda or ISIS with aspirations to attack the United States is a very real possibility." Mackenzie later addressed the question of whether the U.S. was in a position to counter such a threat. "Think we're still seeing how Al-Qaeda and ISIS are configuring themselves against the Taliban," he said. "We're still seeing whether the Taliban is going to do, so I think, I would not say I'm confident that that's going to be on the ground yet." Milley defends China calls Alto the Herring was intended to dissect the Biden administration's stance on Afghanistan. Milley used his opening statements to answer claims he made, secret calls to his Chinese counterpart and offered to warn him of any impending U.S. attack in the final days of the Trump presidency. The allegations were made in Peril, a new book by Bob Woodward and Robert Costa. It cited Beijing's fears that Trump was looking to start a war with China as his potential election loss loomed. Milley confirmed the broad premise of the book but denied that the calls were secret. He said they were part of the usual business of being chairman of the Joint Chiefs of STAFF and explained that the calls had been coordinated with the U.S. government. "No, I am certain, President Trump did not intend on attacking the Chinese and it is my directed responsibility to convey presidential orders and intent," he said. "My message again was consistent. Calm, steady, de-escalate. We are not going to attack you." Impact of the Doha Agreement. The two senior commanders said the Doha Agreement, signed under President Trump after negotiations with the Taliban in the Qatari capital, had a negative impact on the morale and performance of the Afghan security forces. It essentially set a deadline for the U.S. withdrawal in return for the Taliban agreeing not to attack American forces. As senators probed whether the Biden administration should have had a clearer idea of the fragile nature of the Afghan military, Mackenzie and Milley pointed to the agreement and its damaging fallout. Mackenzie said, "It's my judgment that the Doha Agreement did negatively affect the performance of the Afghan forces, in particular by some of the actions the government of Afghanistan was required to take as part of that agreement. The deal required Kabul to release 5,000 Taliban prisoners in exchange for 1,000 Afghan government troops, as well as starting the withdrawal of thousands of American contractors who had supported local forces." Milley added that in his assessment the Doha deal did affect the morale of the Afghan security forces. Drone strike investigation. The three witnesses faced questions about the August 29 drone strike that killed 10 civilians but said they might better be answered during an afternoon session behind closed doors. Austin said they had not yet been in touch with their crew responsible for the strike. "I've directed a 3-star review of this incident," he said. Jen. Mackenzie did an initial investigation, and he directed a 3-star review and so he won't make any comments. The issue came up again later during the hearing when Hen. Mackenzie was asked whether it was possible to adequately assess targets without intelligence assets on the ground. SED took full responsibility for the strike. "The matter is under investigation, but what I can tell you broadly, and to restate some things that I've said earlier, I am responsible for that," he said. "It happened in my area of responsibility, so I'm the responsible officer for that strike." And he said on this occasion the intelligence was tragically wrong. "Was under no pressure, and no one in my chain of command below me was under any pressure to take that strike. We acted based on the intelligence read that we saw on the ground," he said. Republicans in particular have intensified their attacks on President Joe Biden's decision to pull all troops out of Afghanistan by the end of last month, saying it left the U.S. more vulnerable to terrorism. They are also demanding more details on the suicide bombing in Kabul that killed 13 American service members in the final days of the withdrawal. In an early hostile salvo, Sen. Jim Inhofe, the top Republican on the committee, offered a withering analysis of the administration's withdrawal and future strategy for Afghanistan. "There is no plan. We have no reliable partners on the ground. We have no bases nearby," he said in his opening statement. "The Afghan government is now led by terrorists with long ties to Al-Qaeda. And we're at the mercy of the Pakistan government to get into Afghanistan airspace. Even if we can get there, we can't strike Al-Qaeda in Afghanistan because we're worried about what the Taliban will do to the Americans still there." Comillas sencillas.